Welcome, everyone. We're just going to leave about another minute or so for people who are joining in. Thrilled to have you here for our fourth masterclass. For those that are just joining, we'll just be another 30 seconds or so to let to people join the seminar, and we'll get going. Okay, so we'll start now. And for those that are just joining, we are at our fourth masterclass, Sport and Exercise Medicine, and MSK masterclass. We're thrilled to have Dr. Bruce Forster here joining us today. And before we get started, I'm just going to welcome you. My name is Dr. Jane Thornton. I'm a sport and exercise medicine physician and researcher. And I'm speaking to you from Western University in London, Ontario, Canada. And I'll just open with a land acknowledgement from where I'm situated, where our lab is situated, that's holding this webinar. We acknowledge that it's sacred land upon which we are privileged to live and work. We recognize the deep connection and longstanding relationship between Indigenous peoples in the land of Southwest Ontario and of London. We acknowledge the Anishinaabek, Haudenosaunee, Lunapewak, and Chenongtan nations whose traditional lands we are gathered upon today. And we're deeply grateful to have the opportunity to be in this place. And so as we open, as we do with each masterclass, we have a few housekeeping items. We've turned off the chat and we'll be using the Q&A today. So as you would like, just feel free to drop in any questions as they come up in the Q&A box. And you can also upvote them if you see a question that you would like to see answered. You can just like them, and essentially that will put the highest rated questions up at the top, and that's what I'll be using as we go through the session. We will save all questions until the end, and we'll go through them at the end for about 15 minutes or so. We'll have a 40-minute presentation by Dr. Forster, and also just to mention that this masterclass was developed with input from our scientific planning committee. So thanks to Dr. Eric Wan and Wong and Dr. Sadia Jan. And I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today. So Dr. Forster joined UBC in 1991. He is a professor in the Department of Radiology, head of MRI in Vancouver Coastal Region, and director of medical imaging at Vancouver General and UBC Hospitals. He was recently director of diagnostic imaging for the Vancouver 2010 Winter Olympic Paralympic Games. And as an associate member of the Allen McGavin Sports Medicine Center, he's been involved in the clinical, education, and research aspects of sports imaging for 16 years. Dr. Forster is associate editor of the journals Radiology and British Journal of Sports Medicine, and is on the honorary editorial board of Open Access Journal of Sports Medicine. He is the author of more than 80 peer-reviewed scientific publications and 90 educational exhibits. He has served as president of the Pacific Northwest Radiology Society and on the board of directors of the Canadian Association of Radiologists. So I'm thrilled to have you here, Dr. Forster. I know we're going to learn a ton, as I always do when I get the chance to listen and learn from you. So the floor is yours, and I will be back to facilitate the Q&A at the end.
Well, thanks so much, Jane. It's a real honor to be invited. Fowler Kennedy is one of the greatest sports medicine institutes in the world, and to be invited is a real honor. So I'm going to talk today about the topic I think I hope is relevant to most on the line. I understand we have primary care physicians, sports med docs, physiotherapists, and other professionals. You know, how do you determine what the best radiologic investigation is? And maybe there's some times in which the answer is no radiologic investigation is the best. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. Program disclosures in a general sense for Dr. Thornton and Dr. Wong are listed here. And we're going to mitigate potential bias by ensuring that the data and recommendations are presented in a fair, balanced way. I have my own speaker disclosure. Just to update, I am a member of the International Olympic Commission Medical and Scientific Commission, as well as the other disclosures. So here's what we hope to achieve in the next 40 minutes or so. First, you know, when trying to decide what tests to perform, if any, radiation exposure is an important consideration, especially in the axial skeleton and in younger athletes. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to recognize clinical scenarios, as I mentioned, in which no imaging may be the best approach. And then finally, using a case-based kind of approach, we're going to look at sports injuries, which do require imaging in order to determine the best treatment pathway and the best test under those circumstances. So let's get started. So I don't think I need to tell this audience too much about the dramatic increase in the use of imaging in management of injuries in sport in the last 20 years. And this is due to a whole bunch of factors. The diversity of sporting options and the extension of participation into younger and older age groups. And I'll use an example like pickleball, for example. I'm sure there are picklers in this audience, and this is a sport that's increased 40% in the last 3 years. There are now 5 million pickleballers in the US and 1 million in Canada. And with it brings, you know, an assortment of injuries, particularly given that this sport is played generally by older athletes. But there are other indications, of course, you know, other data we can look at. In the time period 1996 to 2005, there was a boom in MSK imaging exams. They went up by huge percentage points, both MRI and ultrasound. And if you look at, you know, more specific scenarios like the Winter Olympics, for example, the number of imaging exams there has tripled from Salt Lake City to Pyeongchang, in which it was over 1,400. Now, another place you can look, of course, is in the newspaper or online, right? Because the media is always talking about, you know, athletes and imaging. And here's two examples. One historic, Mike Piazza, the famous catcher from New York Mets and LA Dodgers. Here's the headline. You know, he's going back to New York. He had a knee injury. He's going to get an MRI. It's going to answer all our questions, right? And then more recently, November 5th of last year, Alphonso Davies, you may recall, just before the World Cup, suffered a hamstring injury. And the headline there was, further scans tomorrow will reveal the exact extent of the injury. So, wow, you know, no pressure here. I guess, you know, these things are common in the media. So suffice to say that imaging in sports is really on fire. It is a very important, but by no means singular aspect of assessing athletes' injuries. So if you do decide to image, what sort of concerns or considerations should there be? And certainly ionizing radiation is one of those. And there's two things in particular that make it something you need to be concerned about. One is the axial skeleton. So the axial skeleton is closely situated to radiosensitive organs. Okay, so you want to minimize x-rays, CTs, et cetera, of the axial skeleton. Also, our group is not always, but often younger patients, and they are more radiosensitive, about 3 to 4 times more radiosensitive. So that's another important consideration. And of course, we have modalities listed here. We know that the top three, x-ray, CT, and nuclear medicine, all involve ionizing radiation. So we need to consider these modalities based on age and the part of the skeleton we're imaging. Whereas ultrasound and MRI have no ionizing radiation at all. So we can, with impunity, in the right scenarios, use those modalities. Well, you know, we need to understand radiation dose a little bit better because you don't need a benchmark. You know, it's always hard to throw around numbers and people aren't familiar with them. So let's start with the annual background radiation in Canada. And that's measured in millisieverts, and it's 1.8 millisieverts at sea level. To put that in perspective, three views, x-rays of lumbosacral spine, is 1.5 millisieverts. That's almost a year worth of background radiation. And that includes that coned down lateral view of the lumbosacral junction, which is has a lot of radiation. And if you can avoid that, that is a smart move. What about a CT of the same body part, lumbosacral spine? That's 3 millisieverts. So, you know, almost twice annual background. SPECT CT is even higher. But look at a CT of the ankle, 0.001 millisieverts, almost nothing at all, right? So we only use CT in the extremities when it's needed and indicated, but we don't have to worry so much about the radiation dose there. But, you know, we still have a lot of work to do as radiologists in educating clinicians and the public because, you know, in some surveys, clinicians had thought that CT had the lowest radiation dose of all radiologic tests, which is not true. So it's important to educate all of us about the radiation scenario. What about the cancers that are a result from radiation? That's, of course, why we're concerned. The typical lag period is about anywhere from 5 to 15 years. How much excess risk is there? This is quite controversial. It's maybe about 5%. Remember that 1 in 4 people will develop cancer. So I don't want to overstate it. We always want to do the right test. We always want to minimize radiation. But the risk is modest. It's still there, and we will definitely respect that. As a result, we do all we can in imaging to reduce the dose called ALARA as low as reasonably acceptable or available. So we try to keep the dose down at all times. So let's start with our first case. This is Ahmed. He's a 16-year-old football player. He came back after summer vacation, and there was a new coach on the pitch, and new coach put him through the drills, and Ahmed developed some low back pain. And so he took some time off and then went back to play, and it came back. And on physical exam, he had quite a lot of more pain with extension, not really very much tenderness. So these radiographs were obtained, and we'll discuss whether or not the radiographs were necessary, but they were obtained and there was nothing to see. And this continued, and the attending physician was getting quite concerned because it was really restricting his activity. So an MRI was ordered. And what we have here is a T2 sagittal image on your left, which shows the 5 lumbar vertebral bodies, the level sacral junction. Then in the middle, that's B and C and D, we have off midline sagittal images, and the arrows are showing you the white is bone marrow edema in the pars interarticularis. Maybe seen in a more familiar sense on the axial image, that's D on the bottom. The blue and red arrows are showing you bone marrow edema in the pars interarticularis. An image on the right shows you there's no actual fracture. And this, of course, is spondylolysis. And we know this is a very common continuum of an injury to the neural arch, ranging from stress injuries like we see here with bone marrow edema to incomplete fractures, to complete fractures, and then on to spondylolisthesis. And the part of the vertebral body we're talking about is illustrated in the bottom right. And the blue arrow is the pars. And it acts as a pivot point between the superior and inferior facet. And the shear forces begin inferiorly at the medial margin of this joint. And we absolutely do want to, you know, diagnose this early because it can reduce recovery time, but it can be challenging. It's not uncommon at all, 4 to 6% incidence, but much higher in younger elite athletes, and especially in certain sports. And many of us know the sports that, you know, involve hyperextension, which increase the risk of this type of injury, things like diving, volleyball, cricket, especially fast pitchers, baseball, these types of sports. The most common level is L5. L4 is the second most common level. Now, how do we image that? So let's say we are concerned, the history is concerning for a pars injury. X-rays really are not useful. That's a Scotty dog. And in radiology, we used to talk about on the oblique view, you look for the Scotty dog, and the pars defect is through the neck. Please don't ever order oblique views of the lumbosacral spine. By the time you've done the oblique views, you might as well have done a CT, which is a much better exam to assess the pars. So X-rays are not useful. CT, as we know, in Ahmed's case, he's 16. We'd rather not use CT. It has 3 millisieverts of radiation. And it's not very sensitive to the stress reaction. That's the bone marrow edema. It is good to show healing of it, and we sometimes will use it. And there's a new kit on the block called Dual Energy CT, which I won't get into, but that can maybe one day show us things like bone marrow edema. We want to avoid SPECT CT because of the radiation. So MRI is the test of choice. And it is very sensitive in showing the earliest phases of this stress reaction. That is the bone marrow edema, as long as you use the STIR or other fat suppressed sequences. Some studies have suggested that you might be able to tell if there's going to be extension to a pars defect itself. That's a bit controversial. Sometimes we will say in select cases, okay, you know, if you're worried about healing of this stress fracture, then we will do a single level CT, but we will really restrict that in SAM and only do it when absolutely necessary. So spondylolysis MRI is a great way to go in young athletes. Second case, pretty familiar, I'm sure, to many of you, a 17-year-old female with signs and symptoms of a tibial stress fracture. So what do we do here? Well, best practice really is that imaging is usually not required. It's a clinical diagnosis, responds well to conservative management. But if for some reason it's atypical, the patient's not responding to conservative measures, you need to image, MRI is the way to go. You want to avoid a bone scan in young patients in particular because it has a fair amount of radiation. In MRI, the signal changes occur very early in the course of symptoms. And as we'll see in a minute, they correlate quite well with return to play. So, and I'll review that in the next slide. But you got clinical correlation is really important because you can get some stress-like reactions in asymptomatic, you know, long-distance runners, for example. So we're only talking about symptomatic athletes here in terms of these imaging findings. And there's one study, this study is getting pretty old, it's 20 years old, but you know, this author looked at, you know, if you had a patient who's young and you made a diagnosis of stress fracture within 3 weeks of onset of symptoms, then return to play was much shorter than if you waited longer to successfully make the diagnosis. I mean, it makes sense, right? The condition is progressing. So MRI is the way to go. And there's this this grading system called the Fredrickson system, which again has been around for a long, long time, since early 2000s. And it is actually quite a good grading system. You know, return to play is such a hard thing. It's not just imaging at all, but this system seems to have stood the test of time as a helper in return to play. And basically there's grade 1 through 4, and grade 1 is that there is high signal on this stir fluid sensitive sequence, just at the periosteum. And in the upper right, you'll see the white arrow showing that bright signal, the white stuff. That's periosteal reaction. That's the earliest grade 1 stress injury. And then as you go through grade 2, you get edema, that's that white stuff in the medullary canal. And up to grade 4, in which you get a low signal line. And I'll show you that in the next slide. But look at the return to play. I mean, as you go up the grading system, return to play really does get longer. So here's the example of a grade 4 Fredrickson tibial stress fracture. We see there is bone marrow edema within the medullary canal, shown by the gold arrows. But on the right, you'll see there is a low signal T1 on the T1 wave sequence, a low signal line indicating that there's a actual fracture through there. So that's a grade 4. That would be expected to require more rest and a longer return to play. So hopefully helpful for athletes, patients, and practitioners using these kinds of systems. So definitely MRI for tibial stress fractures, but also definitely no imaging for most of them. The third case is a familiar one as well, I'm sure for many of you. A 20-year-old guy with a 2-week history of some low back pain and in radicular symptoms. And, you know, this is just another day in the clinic for most of you, I'm sure, in that, you know, low back pain is the 6th most common complaint in the emergency department in the U.S., some 3 million visits a year. And the cost of imaging and treating low back pain is absolutely huge. We know in the U.S. that 42% of patients with low back pain get an imaging test within 1 year of presentation. And we know it's really common in athletes as well, especially in some sports. Wrestling, gymnasts have been shown to have higher incidence of low back pain compared to age match controls. Other sports, dancing, skiing as well, quite common. And the list is long. So if you decide to image, one of the problems is, okay, well, what do you do with the findings, right? And this is a big problem with low back imaging. We know the disc protrusions are incredibly common in asymptomatic people, almost 30% at age 20 and getting close to 45% by age 80. We also know that just because you have disc herniation doesn't mean that it won't spontaneously regress. It doesn't mean you need surgery. We know that they spontaneously regress. We also know that MR findings don't always correlate with symptoms. In one study, 2/3 of 57 patients with radicular symptoms had no match between the MRI and the clinical findings. Now, the most important thing on MRI, and I want to illustrate this with the images on the right, is the position of the disc herniation and its mass effect. That's the real beauty of MRI. It shows very nicely, with good contrast resolution, the disc against the nerve or thecal sac. So here we have an L5-S1 disc herniation shown on this 22-weighted sagittal sequence on the top with a blue arrow. And then on the bottom, we have the axial sequence right through there showing the disc herniation is compressing the left S1 nerve root. Okay. So, and that indeed correlated with this patient's symptoms. So that's really the beauty of MRI. Now, it's important to remember, though, that 80% of athletes in one study treated conservatively who had disc herniation returned to play successfully at 5 months. So we know that just because you see a disc herniation doesn't mean that an intervention, surgically or otherwise, is required. It may explain the pain better. However, it doesn't at all mean that a surgical intervention is necessary. Another really important point is the old saying, you are not your MRI. And it's a good saying because, you know, don't treat the image, treat the patient. It's critically important to get a good history. And that's where we rely on you. There's one prospective study quite well done in our literature just a couple of years ago. Looked at 120 patients with low back pain, and they had an electronic questionnaire completed by patients. And that resulted in a lot better kappa value for determination of the pain generator on MRI compared to a clinical gold standard than when the MRI was reviewed without the clinical data. And this is just another example of how important that clinical data is for us and in trying to, together as a team, help the patient in the most optimized way. It also may help us avoid incidental findings that are unrelated being acted upon. So one of the problems with low back pain is that it's over-imaged. And we wrote this editorial, British Journal of Sports Medicine, a few years ago to that effect. And let's just review quickly, how to know when to image. And red flags have been around a long time. And acute low back pain less than 6 weeks, these red flags apply. Back pain more than 6 weeks in duration is itself a red flag. Okay, that's important to keep in mind. So the old eponym tuna fish, if you care to use that, is the one that this chart refers to. And, you know, what about the evidence for red flags? Well, it's actually not great. You can see the prevalence here. They're quite common. And there's not a lot of great evidence in the literature to support them. Some are better than others, okay? Recent trauma, age over 50, cancer history and weight loss, infection, IV drug use, these are good red flags. However, things like night pain, incontinence, we all know these are common and not particularly predictive. And indeed, the absence of a red flag does not rule out a particular red flag diagnosis. So what do you do? Well, I think the key is to use red flags judiciously, especially in combination, one, two, or three red flags together. It's just part of a history and physical examination. And when they were written, they were never meant to be standalone indications. A watchful waiting is an important part of the strategy. It's hard, but you don't want to lose patients to follow-up. Some patients may not give you a choice in that regard, but that's important. More research, hey, you know, AI solves everything, right? Maybe AI can help us here too, figure out, just how red flags play into clinical decision-making. But we know that, the pressure is to make an early diagnosis because, we want to improve the patient's outcome, and whether that's to sport or otherwise. So we felt that in our community, we had a problem with over-imaging back pain. So we did, I just show this as an example of an intervention you can do. We published this in the Journal of American College of Radiology here. And what we did was in a busy ER in urban Vancouver, we planned a QA/QI intervention, which involved clinical decision support tools at point of care in the emergency ward. And the ED physicians, when they said they wanted a CT or an MR of lumbar sacral spine, up would pop this little page. And what they had to do is indicate the reason for the exam with the red flags and boxes. But we also had a box where they could free text the reason they wanted the exam. This is called a medium stop. So, you know, they could get the exam even if, you know, they put in something in that box that maybe wasn't entirely kosher, still get the examination, no need to call anybody. But then we would review what was in the box and we would look at, at the results. And we had a couple of metrics we used. The first metric was, okay, low back pain visits as proportion of all ED visits. And the important metric, low back pain visits with a medical imaging order as a proportion of all low back pain visits. So how many patients with low back pain in this ED got a medical imaging exam before the intervention, okay, in the pre-intervention analysis, and post-intervention? Did it make a difference or not? What we saw was that it did make a difference. So point of care decision support is in literature been generally shown to be quite effective. We're able to show a 5% decrease in use of imaging. That may not seem like a lot, but if you look at that across the province, that's a large number of imaging examinations. And we were able also to show that those patients did not return for other imaging exams and no important dangerous diagnoses were missed. Two important things to consider. So we then extended, as you do in QA/QI projects, this to a broader, we deployed it more broadly. And now in the Lower Mainland of Vancouver, in order to get an MRI, you have to fill out this page at central intake, and then it's a form of decision support, and this has also resulted in fewer low back pain examinations using MR and CT. Okay, let's move on. We have 7 cases in total, so we're almost about halfway through. This is another familiar one: 60-year-old male with 3-month history of worsening medial right knee pain. So this is another kind of QA/QI thing for us. So what I noticed, when I was reading MRs, was that we were getting a lot of patients with moderate to end stage OA in which query meniscal tear was the indication for the examination. And so we felt there was an opportunity to reduce the volume of these low value outpatient MRI examinations in older patients. So we published this paper, and I'll just briefly summarize it in one slide, albeit a busy one. So basically, when the rec came in, we were looking for red flags, and for knee MRI, they're not that many. It's like query sarcoma, is there an infection, or is there a fixed lock knee? Not intermittent locking knee, that's not a red flag, a fixed lock knee. So pretty uncommon. If yes, of course we go on to an MRI. If no, then we would review the radiographs. And for this project, we actually reviewed them ourselves. And we used the Kellgren-Lawrence validated assessment for osteoarthritis. And if they had true joint space narrowing on a weight-bearing exam, so that's as seen on the top left on the right image, then that's Kellgren-Lawrence 3. And they would get a letter saying that this patient does not really qualify for an MRI because they have coexistent moderate to severe OA. MR is not likely to change management. And the patient would get information too. And I think in both the ER QA project and in this one, it's really important to communicate the what the project's all about to the referring doctor, to the ER doctor in the first case, and to the patient. Super important to make sure the patient understands what's going on. So when we did this study, we found that we were able to decrease the number of the MRIs in patients with osteoarthritis. And we were able to do that by about 16%. And the run rate just shown on the bottom for the target exams. So, and again, if you look at across the problems of BC, just for knee and hip, that would, save us 1,872 exams, which, in a resource restricted environment, such as we have in many parts of Canada, if not the whole country, that's significant. Now you could take it a step further because we know this article by Savonin, from the New England Journal, was a landmark article in which their team showed that arthroscopic partial meniscectomy was no better than sham arthroscopy in preventing OA in patients with degenerative meniscal tears. So you could argue that maybe everybody over 55, whether they have osteoarthritis or not, would not benefit as much from an MRI. We didn't take it that far, and I think that's still up for debate. But there are reasons for sure when one might want to do an MRI in those in that age group. So, but with coexisting OA, it doesn't really make sense. The operation that they eventually need will be a knee replacement, and that's best assessed with plain films. Okay. Case number five is a younger patient, 21-year-old female, training for half marathon with right hip pain. You know, there's all sorts of things this could be, right? Greater trochanteric bursitis, maybe snapping iliopsoas tendon, gluteus medius, if she was older, maybe tendinopathy, maybe a labral tear. But let's say that you're thinking, based on history, that this could be a femoral neck stress fracture. She's in a good age group for that. And that would be an important consideration for imaging, because there are three pretty common stress fractures that always need imaging. We know for the most part that we don't image stress fractures, as we talked about with the tibia, but there are three sites that are particularly important to always image. One is the femoral neck, the tension side more than compression side. That's the lateral side more than the medial side, but I would suggest imaging both with MRI. We want to avoid CT. MRI is more sensitive. It's close to the axial skeleton. The tarsal navicular is another one, because it's such an important key, you know, kind of, it's a keystone of the foot, right? And if that goes on to EVN or a full fracture, you've got a big problem biomechanically. We'd recommend MRI, or if unavailable, CT for the tarsal navicular stress fractures. And finally, the dreaded black line, as we call it, the mid-tibial transverse stress fracture, probably best assessed with CT, although MR is maybe in second place. The reason is there's so much sclerosis, the bone is so thick there, MR has a bit of trouble seeing edema. CT works quite well. I'll show you an example of that. Why are these high-risk stress fractures? Because if they go on to a full-thickness cortical break, these are critical load-bearing areas. We don't want to have to do, an IM nail. If we can avoid it, we don't have to do a hemiarthroplasty in a young 21-year-old. So always important to get an MRI. Here's an example of these stress fractures, high-risk stress fractures. On the left, top left, you see the blue arrow showing you a stress fracture of the medial femoral neck, the compression side. In the middle images, you see the blue arrow showing you, it's a bit subtle, but there's a transverse line there through the tibial cortex of the midshaft, which is classic for this dreaded black line. You can actually have several of them in the same patient. And on CT, we see this as a lot of sclerosis there. And on the far right, you see this patient didn't need an IM nail. These just do not heal well. So you want to know what's going on with them as soon as possible and strongly, aggressively manage them, albeit conservatively with regard to weight bearing. And finally, the tarsal navicular, we know the middle third shown in blue there is pretty avascular. And that's where these always occur. They're so predictable where the navicular stress fractures occur. The dorsal aspect of the proximal articular surface, the CT in the middle shows it's a transverse image. The talonavicular joint is shown there, and the blue arrow shows you the stress fracture. And then on MR, this is a coronal view of the navicular. We see the bone marrow edema in that same location. So examples of high-risk stress fractures. Case six is a 45-year-old basketball player who had a history of an ankle rollover. Okay, so as usual, you know, we'd apply the Ottawa ankle rules here and decide whether or not they needed plain films. But let's say that this patient wasn't getting better, still could not weight bear after indeed fulfilling Ottawa ankle rules. There's no fracture, but you're concerned about a syndesmotic injury. And this requires a high degree of suspicion, because they occur in the minority of ankle sprains. But in some sports, like ice hockey is probably one of the most familiar sports for these injuries, they're much more common. And the return to play for patients with a syndesmotic injury in ice hockey is 45 days compared to like less than 2 days of the routine ankle sprain. So an important diagnosis to make and to manage. They are, however, these syndesmotic injuries rarely isolated. They occur with Weber B and Weber C fractures, and also with deltoid ligament, the deep layer, the tibio-talar ligament of the deltoid. And the problem is that physical examination is not great. People look for bruising above the joint line. The radiographs are not great. There's these rules about tibiofibular overlap, and medial clear space, but they're not great depending on how the images were exposed. So high degree of suspicion is necessary. And if you're suspicious of this diagnosis, an MRI is the way to go. The most commonly injured part of this ligamentous complex is the anterior-inferior tibiofibular ligament. We see the usual thing on MR. We see ligament discontinuity, redundancy. It's not tight or taut, it's redundant. And we also see high T2 signal. There's other things you can do like arthrography. People really don't do that anymore. How good is MRI for this diagnosis? It's pretty good. The studies are not huge, but the ones we have seem to show good sensitivity and specificity. There's maybe some promise of dynamic ultrasound here, where you stress the joint and show an increased gap anteriorly. And that is still early days though. So, but that would be a nice advance. And we also see other injuries with this type of scenario. They're quite devastating injuries. So you'll often have an anterior tear, fibular ligament tear, bone marrow edema, the tater dome, posterior medial malleolar bone marrow edema, these kinds of things. And I want to show you an example of a syndesmotic injury on MRI. And in the middle, I'm going to show you what the normal looks like. So the blue arrow in the middle image shows you the anterior inferior tibiofibular ligament. And on the left, what we see is a big joint effusion. This is a transverse image. And there's nobody home there, right? That blue arrow shows that there is no ligament at all at the position of the anterior inferior tibiofibular. The green arrow is showing you some bone marrow edema in the medial malleolus, which we mentioned was a common associated injury. And on the right, we see some edema extending superiorly into the syndesmosis, which is typical. So syndesmotic injuries really well evaluated with MRI and an important diagnosis. Our last case is a different age group entirely, a 9-year-old female with right knee hemarthrosis. Based on how rapidly the effusion developed, it was felt to be hemarthrosis following a gym injury. Now, the most common cause of hemarthrosis in an adult we know is an ACL tear. In children, it's actually the patellar injury, whether it's dislocation or this injury called patellar sleeve avulsion. Now, this is an important injury, this patellar sleeve avulsion. It's not super common, but it is, if you look at all pediatric patellar fractures, it's pretty common, but those are not common in general. The age group, as you can see here, is younger, and they present with this hemarthrosis. And the tricky part is shown in the diagram is you pull away the periosteum, which of course you can't see on an x-ray, okay? But you might take a small bone fragment with it, which allows you to see it. And it's usually at the inferior pole, can sometimes be superiorly. The x-ray finds can be really subtle. In fact, you can see almost nothing. So if you have a hemarthrosis in a young child, sporting injury, an MRI is the way to go because it'll show this injury. And here we see it here. The plain film on the left does show a small bone fragment at the inferior pole of the patella. There's also a diffusion or hemarthrosis, as we can see. And then the MR on the right shows, again, that fragment, which is displaced inferiorly about a few millimeters, which is an indication for operative repair, because you really need your extensor mechanism, right? It has to be intact in order to stand and to walk. So very important injury not to miss. So bottom line, hemarthrosis in child, strongly consider an MRI to evaluate the patella, and in particular, not to miss patellar sleeve avulsions. So I was asked to include a slide on barriers to practice change, and there are definitely barriers here. The accessibility of these imaging modalities in the rural setting and in the urban setting is an issue in Canada, without question. So we'll talk a bit about that. Obviously, the accessibility in the same sense of timely surgical treatment is also a barrier. Patient expectations are always tough. And you're all at the coalface, and radiologists for the most part aren't. So that's something that we need to understand when we make recommendations as we do. So what about this difficulty, for example, in getting an MRI? Well, fortunately, ultrasound is diagnostic for many MSK problems. It competes with MRI, in fact, in centers which have the technologic and radiologic expertise. The technology is really important because MSK ultrasound is not easy. But the more superficial your lesion is, the better ultrasound is at making the diagnosis. So things like tendons, ligaments, and bursa, clinical scenarios such as ulnar side of wrist pain, ultrasound works really well, rotator cuff tears, elbow tendinopathies, greater trochanteric bursitis, Baker cysts, ankle ligaments, Achilles tendons. These are all really well evaluated by ultrasound. Generally speaking, much easier to get in Canada than MRI. In fact, ultrasound is better than MRI for some things like snapping tendons and to direct any biopsy. For sure, that's the way to go, ultrasound. Now, if you're worried about an ACL tear or deeper structures, then or cartilage abnormalities, whether that's hyaline cartilage or fibrocartilage like menisci and labra, ultrasound is not going to help you. Okay, that's when you need to stick to things like an MRI. Do energy CT, as I mentioned, is showing promise there, but it's still not ready for prime time. And point of care ultrasound, POCUS, many of you probably use ultrasound yourselves in your practice, and this is evolving. The handheld ones still have a way to go. I think I'd be a little reluctant to do a POCUS exam of a rotator cuff tear, but I'd have no problem looking at the Achilles tendon. So I think it's a bit nuanced right now, but the technology is really improving. And I'm sure that we'll be able to do, you know, one day all MSK exams using these portable devices. Some examples of ultrasound diagnoses that the topic really is MRI today, but in terms of barriers to practice change, here's some examples that ultrasound is really shown here. So on the top left, it's a short axis view of the proximal humerus. The bicipital groove is shown. Labeled and the bicipital tendon, long head of biceps is dislocated immediately. Classic dislocated biceps tendon, shown beautifully in ultrasound. In fact, I'd rather use ultrasound than an MR here. On the bottom left, you see on the left, the normal right patellar tendon, and on the left, the patient's left tendon is abnormal. You can see in the blue circle, we've lost that fibrillar equitexture and it's thickened. Classic case of jumper's knee patellar tendinopathy. Ultrasound is brilliant for this. And finally, on the right, we have a case from my colleague in literature. It is a case of ECU, eccentric carpal ulnaris, tendinopathy in a golfer. Actually, tenosynovitis would be the better word. This fluid surrounding the tendon in the long axis view on the top. And on the short axis view on the bottom, we see the tendon is thickened, it's echogenic, this fluid around it, and color flow shows increased vascularity. Classic for eccentric carpal ulnaris, tenosynovitis. So ultrasound works so well here. So in conclusion, do consider carefully about CT, nuclear medicine, bone scan, and x-rays of the axial skeleton in young patients. Of course, there are times when it's absolutely necessary, when benefit outweighs the risk. But just remember to consider MR and ultrasound when possible to avoid the risk of radiation. Also important to remember there are clinical scenarios such as low back pain and knee pain in older patients in the absence of red flags that likely don't require imaging at all, at least on first presentation. So important to keep that in mind. And ultrasound can be diagnostic and is more readily available in many MSK settings, such as ulnar side of wrist pain, rotator cuff tear, and superficial tendon ligament injury. So the more you are confident you're dealing with a superficial structure and only one structure that is injured, the better ultrasound is. The more you think that it's deep or involving multiple structures, the more MR shines as a one-stop shop. And the bottom conclusion here is the key one. Care of athletes of any level is a team sport. Much like the team that supports athletes like these, we're all here trying to do our best for our patients and our athletes. And so please feel free to consult your radiologist anytime. There's some great ones in London who I know personally. I'm very happy to take questions now. Thank you for your time.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Bruce. That was fantastic. It's really interesting because I know that we have some international listeners and viewers here as well. And I know that it's always tricky with the way that we operate in Canada with how we order the wait times of some of these images as well, imaging modalities, and the kind of the socioeconomic aspects of rural areas and private and public clinics and so on. So Might get your take on that, but we do have a couple of questions first. Just going through, I know we have three questions actually. So, and then we'll keep them coming if people want to just add them in the chat. We have probably a good 10-13 minutes or so before we have to close down. So the first question was, can you explain what STIR means? Do we have to specify this on a requisition? Maybe we'll start with that. There's a part B to that, but
sure. No, I apologize. MRI is heavily lingoized. It really is. So you don't have to worry about that. STIR stands for short conversion recovery. All it means is a type of sequence that shows bone marrow edema or trabecular microfracture really well, or in other pathologies like ligament and tendon injury. You don't have to specify it. All protocols, all we need from you is a good history, and the right sequences will be applied. So you don't need to specify.
Fantastic. And you also mentioned single level CT. Mm-hmm. This is from the attendee. What is this? Is this the same thing as low level CT? Do we have to specify this, or does radiology choose?
Yeah. The single level CT I mentioned was in the setting of a pars defect and trying to follow the pars defect, seeing whether it's healing or not. It's a very, very narrow kind of scenario. Okay. And we don't do this exam very often. My point of mentioning single level was, if you've got Ahmed, who was 16, and you diagnosed a through and through pars defect, and he's not getting better, and you want to know if it's healing, then what we might do is a CT through the level of that vertebra only. Most of the time, CT would be L2 to S1 or L1 to S1. We wouldn't do that in Ahmed because he was 16. Instead, we would do just through the L5 level, try to restrict our range as much as possible. That's what that is. And low dose CT is maybe what the attendee was referring to, is something that we try to practice virtually in every area now. We try to keep the dose as low as we can.
And that's something that you choose versus something that needs to be written on a requisition. Excellent. Okay, yep. Thank you.
If you put exactly what I said, known pars defect L5, pre-healing, then the radiologist will take it from there.
Okay, perfect. Great, thank you. So a second question is, in terms of x-ray versus MRI for slip disc herniation in a low income setting where MRI can be hard to come by, if conservative management would be done either way, would we not start with that and only increased cost if not resolving?
Yeah. Well, I think that's a good question in terms of whether to do imaging at all. I mean, in an older patient who has radicular pain, there's not a lot of downside to doing radiographs of lumbar sacral spine. However, the yield is fairly low. You might see spondylolisthesis, for example, you weren't expecting. You might see a compression fracture. So those things are important. So I wouldn't worry about doing plain X-rays in somebody over 45 or so. You know, it's rent to somewhat gray zone of what the age group is. But it's not going to show any disc pathology at all. Okay, so the herniated disc will not show up on plain radiographs at all. You're looking for other bony things. However, the presence of radicular pain in a query herniated disc is not itself, in absence of red flags or concern of your part, a reason to image, as we were talking about, right? Low back pain, so much of it is spontaneously regresses. And no imaging or treatment is required other than conservative management. So I think we reserve imaging outside of that setting, which could be difficult. If this patient was in a low-income setting and the x-rays showed nothing and you were still worried about a herniated disc, had a red flag, or it was more than 6 weeks, then I think I would push to go to a center that does have the MRI. I think that patient deserves to have an MRI at that point. But that is the minority of patients. Most of those patients with radicular pain, and in fact, who do have a disc herniation, the disc may or may not regress, but the pain will get better within 6 weeks.
Mm-hmm. And do you find that most people would be ordering x-ray before MRI? Do you ever find that people are ordering MRI without the x-ray? And do you find that there's a preference from radiology?
I would say that, the young patients like our example, Ahmed, mm-hmm. I would skip the x-ray there. I mean, mm-hmm. What really are we looking for? He's not going to have a listhesis, not going to have a compression fracture. If there's no trauma, I'd skip the x-ray and go right to MRI. We have no problem with that. We can number the vertebral bodies. We have a way of doing that. We know how many vertebral bodies there are, 4 or 5 or 6 in the lumbar region. So that's not a problem. But in adults, we generally would start with the plank bones.
Excellent. Okay, great. So two more questions. So one is, what is considered, there's a few questions within a question potentially. So the first one is, I'll just read the whole thing. What's considered dreaded black line only if crosses cortex? In that case, we refer to ortho ASAP. If we see a line, but it doesn't cross the cortex and the patient is walking, is this the type of thing we can watch and wait with exam and x-rays for the next few months?
The dread black line is such an interesting diagnosis, and it's got that crazy name, right? Which is part of it, I think.
Right.
It is a real problem for patients and their families and their doctors, right? So it's a transverse line that goes right to the cortex. Okay, to answer the first question, okay, it has to go through the cortex. It's a cortical break, right? It's an extreme stress fracture. And, if you see this, I think it's a good question. I'm not sure that as a radiologist, I'm, able to answer that well. And it maybe depends on your setting and your relationship with your, your consultants. I think that if you saw this, I think most orthopedic surgeons would be quite willing to see the patient because it is something that may require an IM nail. I mean, we hope not, but the example I gave was of one of my colleagues, a physician who was running triathlons and needed to have an IM nail, just couldn't get better. And I think if you had any of those stress fractures that are high risk, femoral neck, a dreaded black line, or a navicular, I think referral to orthopedic surgeon is a good call.
Excellent. Okay, great. We have a few more questions coming. This is great. So I'll go through it. So a young 12-year-old male tennis player with low back pain, pain and extension when serving, comes and goes with increased training and rest helps. Knowing if it is possible pars defect and rest is required, should we request an MRI or single level CT or wait and watch? Or do we just let him rest for 6 weeks, eight weeks, 12 weeks, let him play without an increase in pain? Or do we allow 2 out of 10 pain? So many questions, sorry.
Oh, no, it's fine. Okay. I mean, this is the real world, right? This, you're
exactly.
At the state, you guys are in the...
This is why we have these.
Yeah, this is the real world. So I would say that I think, it depends entirely on your assessment as a clinician. But the example I gave, the patient had no imaging until they had stopped playing soccer, went back and got worse. So a clinical trial of rest, I think, is a good one, plus other conservative management. If it's just low back pain and no other symptoms, then should it not be amenable to conservative therapy, then I would go right to MR. Mm. Okay, because single level CT, I want to be clear on this, is only useful once you know the level of the pars defect. Mm-hmm. Okay, if the patient doesn't have a pars defect, then you don't need to do CT at all. The MRI is the first test that will show you what's wrong, maybe nothing. But if there is a pars defect then, or bone marrow edema, stress fracture in the pars, then MR will show that. And generally speaking, you won't have to worry about the CT unless remember that very specific scenario I said, is it healing? The patient's not getting better. We now know there's a pars defect. The patient's not responding. Is it healing? Then we do the single level CT.
Fantastic. Yeah. So next, we're almost finished. So it's a fantastic discussion. Thank you. So the next attendee is asking, can you comment on the indications for MRI on a hamstring strain? Is the value of the diagnosis, the therapy guidance, or prognosis? So return.
That's a super good question. So how much time have I got? Have I got half an hour?
Exactly. You have about 4 minutes, but we won't.
I actually did a debate on this at the podium about use of MRI and hamstring tears. We didn't have a chance to cover everything in 40 minutes, obviously, but this is another area that's got a lot of interesting literature on. So hamstring tears, in elite and professional athletes always get images, just no question about it. In other athletes, it depends, on what their activity level is and how serious the injury seems to be clinically. If you're going to image, you have a couple of choices. You could do ultrasound. Ultrasound is pretty good for, say, biceps femoris, which is the commonest hamstring to tear in soccer, for example. Depending on the body habitus, but generally speaking, it does a pretty good job. It can tell you if it's completely normal, which is helpful. Mm-hmm. What's the gold standard? MRI is the gold standard. There's no question. What is its role in return to play? That's where the half an hour is required or maybe longer, because it's debatable. There's various grading systems, so many that it makes your head spin. And that alone should tell you something when there's that many grading systems. We use something called the British Athletic Muscle Injury, or BAMI, which some of you might be familiar with, developed by Neil Pollock in the UK. And it's based on the size of the tear and whether the central tendon is involved. I think most people would agree that if you involve the central tendon in a hamstring tear, return to play will be longer and recurrence risk is higher. Okay, so that's what we're looking for. We're looking for how much of the tendon is, what's the extent of the edema in the hamstring injury? Is there redundancy or indeed a defect in the central tendon? Those are the things that the referring docs, orthopedic surgeons, sports med docs want to know. So gold standard is MR, but ultrasound can also do a good job.
Excellent. It's amazing as we talk about this. There's one other comment here, which I think is an important one. It feeds into a little bit of this question around a bit of advocacy and trying to think about what our roles as in terms of decreasing potential radiation or cost, or how can we kind of serve the sport medicine community better, or our patients who are active. So our last guest is saying we have such issues here in South Africa in the public sector. Often advanced scans, CT, MRI cannot be done until basic x-rays are done. Even when you motivate about radiation in children, it's a daily and constant battle. And I wanted to ask your opinion, Bruce, just about that as well. It's just in the sense of, obviously you've done some advocacy in BC around what are appropriate scans and things like that. And I've come across a study when I was looking at low back pain myself about some radiologists putting a paragraph at the bottom of a report saying, in terms of the percentage of people who actually do have abnormal findings on MRI, or to put it into context when clinicians are having these conversations with their patients. So we have about 2 minutes left, and I was just wondering if on any of those aspects, do you feel that there's what role can radiology play, maybe, or us as we as clinicians in terms of trying to advocate for better use of imaging and advocacy for our patients?
Well, I certainly understand the issue that our South African colleague is mentioning. The public sector in some countries is tough, but there are guidelines. Okay, now it depends on the country. American guidelines are very different than Canadian guidelines, but you can go to the literature and find guidelines for imaging things like low back pain. Okay, and they're very clear on what to do and when to do it. So if you need some extra evidence to back up your, if that's going to help at the administrative level, at the political level, then please do so, because those are well-researched, expert panel type recommendations. In terms of the second point, it's a really good one. So yeah, we will put at the bottom, we have a little paragraph or a couple of lines at the bottom of our lumbar spine report saying, please remember that lumbar disc herniations occur in, 30% of patients 40 and over, right? Just to put it in perspective. And I think education across the board, both respect to, the indications, when to image, how to image, is really, really important. And then point of care, anything is great. And so when you're reading the report, that's kind of point of care in a way. So that's the time to remind people. People come to talks and they hear stuff and then they, may or not remember it. We all have that problem. But if it's point of care where you're looking at the report, okay, here's the reminder. I think that's really beneficial. Also for patients, we don't want to catastrophize things. Mm-hmm. So we have changed how we're reporting, so as not to make things sound horrible. I mean, an easy example is I don't use the term annular tear anymore in lumbar spine exams. I use annular fissure because tear sounds like something that needs to be repaired. Right. And it catastrophizes it for the patient. So we need to be careful of the language we use and make things sound, put them in perspective for patients and increasingly patients as they go to portals, but also referring physicians.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We'll end on that note. And again, just it's such an honor to have you here joining us. And we're so thankful for your expertise and your insight and all the experience that you bring to this in a very select population, but of course, in all the patients that you've seen over the years. It's really interesting to see the perspective for radiology as well, in the sense of even helping us determine return to play, make those decisions, and for our primary care physicians who are joining us today and to be able to understand the nuances behind why we order images and why we have those checklists and things like that. So that's been extremely helpful. I want to thank everyone who's joined today, people who have joined live, of course, and then those who will be watching the recording later. Tomorrow, you'll be sent an email containing a link to the participant evaluation survey. So in that survey, you have the option to indicate whether or not you need a certificate of participation for CME. If you click yes, you'll be directed to another link to input your email so that your evaluation remains anonymous. And alternatively, you can reach out to a research coordinator, Becky, and to receive a certificate of participation. So please email us with any questions or concerns. Our research coordinator's email address was sent in the registration email. And so Becky can also put her email in the chat as well. Thanks to everyone joining over your lunch hour or morning or afternoon, evening, wherever you are joining us from and at whatever time. And we hope to see you again at the next masterclass next month. Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you all.